Well now, tonight, Jazz Alley is all about the big P. Extraordinary and indeed extravagant talents of Oscar Emmanuel Peterson, who was born almost 80 years ago. We're sort of revving up for his 80th birthday on the 15th of August, and I thought Jazz Alley would get in a bit early. Born in Montreal, Quebec in Canada, and a professional career stretching back over 60 years, during which he has performed a prodigious, and indeed composed a prodigious amount of music. Done more than anything, anybody, I think, to popularise jazz. There can be very few people who dislike Oscar Peterson, and there are of course, many people who regard him as one of the greatest pianists of all time, and I think I'd be one of them. That was a little piece called A Little Jazz Exercise. We're going to devote the whole programme to Oscar and the whole of next to Saturday's programme as well, so you'll get plenty of chance to hear the right across the spectrum from the early days right through to the current albums. Well now, back to the big P. We won't start right at the beginning. In fact, we'll start quite recently, just to prove that although he had a very debilitating stroke in 1993, he subsequently came back. Here's a large piece from a very fine live recording. Well, if that didn't get your feet tapping, I don't think anything ever will. Oscar Peterson in 1996. That was probably the best of the modern aggregations that he's had. Of course, the drummer was the great British drummer, Martin Drew, always a swinging drummer. Lorne Lofsky, a young Canadian guitarist that was something of a protege of Peterson's. And the bass player was Niels Henning Ørsted Pedersen. Very sad to report that Niels Henning, I'm afraid, died during the period when I was putting this program together. He died on April the 19th. A massive heart attack, and was only age 58, and I think the world is a much poorer place without him. In fact, the obituary in the London Times described him as the greatest jazz bass player of all time. Well, now, I'm just going to go right back, because Peterson, as I said, was born in Montreal, Canada, in relatively humble circumstances. He had a sickly youth. He was in hospital a great deal. His father was actually a night attendant on sleeping car trains, the Canadian Pacific. But Oscar showed incredible skills at the piano almost from the get-go, and he won a talent contest in 1940, which got him all kinds of regular gigs on Canadian radio. And he was quite often featured. From 1944, actually, he was featured with one of the big bands, the Johnny Holmes Orchestra. And then he got going with his own trio. He was often on radio, as I said. And he was unfortunately referred to at the time as the Brown Bomber of Boogie Woogie, because he tended to emphasise that side of his playing. But it seems from eyewitnesses, as it were, that he really always had the technique that he still has. He seems to have emerged fully horned and tailed, ready to go. There doesn't seem to have been any apprenticeship whatsoever. He was spotted, or rather he was listened to, by Norman Granz, the great jazz manager and impresario. In 1949, he heard a radio recording. The legend is that, in fact, he was on the way to the airport in Toronto and he heard Peterson on the piano, and he ordered the taxi, on the radio, he ordered the taxi to turn round, and he went back and found Peterson and suggested that he come with him. And so his first big gigs took place with Norman Granz's Jazz at the Philharmonic, very famous jazz events. And from there on in, of course, Peterson moved to New York, and the rest is history, as they say. We're going to go back to his first band that really made it in New York. It was just a duo. It was with the wonderful Ray Brown. This is a little piece called, appropriately enough, Debut. tell. He'd already left the boogie-woogie some way behind, and in fact his major influence was beginning to show through in a big way, and that's the great Art Tatum. In fact, I think if you were able to clone Art Tatum and Nat King Cole, you'd end up with Oscar Peterson. Well, now we're going to take a piece from an unusual record, an unusual recording, which is actually a piece from a radio program from 1980, which is part of the series of Marion McPartland's Piano Jazz, which is a PBS service that was running for years and years and years in the States and highly acclaimed. McPartland, of course, no spring chicken herself. In fact, she hits 85 this year. But this, when they were young and vital, and Oscar was at the very height of his career, I would think, 1980, just about the top. No, sorry, it was 1978. It was published in 1980, so they took a while to sit on it. It was recorded in the Colonial Tavern, which is a jazz club in Toronto, and the lovely vision I have is that, of course, he's a Bösendorfer artist, so he had to have a Bösendorfer grand freighted in for that, and she is a Baldwin artist, so she had to have a Baldwin grand brought in for that, and the two of them were sort of put back to back in this club, and they talk. Now, I'm going to leave it go quite a bit, so bear with it. It's a lot of technical stuff, but I think it gives you the idea of how much Oscar Peterson thinks about being a piano player.
Oh, Oscar, that is a beautiful tune. Thank you.
Thank you, man.
And welcome. It's nice to have you here doing
nice
the show
to be here
with me.
It's been a long time.
Oh, you know, I was just thinking while you were playing how long it's been, and people always bring this up to me, so I guess you're used to it too. But it was a colonial tavern.
In Toronto.
In Toronto. And I had to go through this ghastly torment of working with Jimmy's band opposite you and Ray Brown.
Oh. And those are in the very formative years, actually. The very early years for us. I think it was just, was it a duo or a trio?
It was a duo.
Yeah. Well, it was the early, duo. Early years.
It was. And, I think it was not too long. Probably after you had Norman Granz had become your manager.
That's
right.
I had done the first tour or two, maybe the first tour of the United States with Jazz the Phil, and had gone out with a duo that was made up of myself and Ray Brown.
I don't know. I don't think you've had any formative years. I just think you've.
Oh, yes,
I think you just started out playing.
I'm still having. Still having a lot of them.
But you know. Of course, you're used to hearing this all the time about prodigious technique, or, as I prefer to say, great chops. You know, you must get tired of hearing that all the time. But also, there are some things that you do that are so typical of you that nobody else does. Like that chord we were speaking about just now, and you just did it again.
Oh.
It's in old folks, it's like 2 seconds together, like two notes. But where you do it in the tune, it just gives a very sad aura to that phrase.
Well, I guess it's a form. I guess if we had to be very classical in our rationalization about it, it would be a form of mild dissonance, wouldn't it? Because it's actually the instead of playing. I would play.
Yeah, we'll see that.
Well, I think what it does, Marion, is I've been doing studying a bit of synthesis recently, and
I noticed that. I want to talk to you about that.
You do. And I find that, for instance, in synthesis, if they want to thicken a note, they will take another voice or a VCO or whatever you want to call it, and add almost any note and put it in sync. Which gives you a fatter note. So you get the same effect almost when you play. But depending on how you control, I mean, what I do is I control the timbre of the, in this case, a B natural against a C. The melody being C, I just barely imply the B natural.
What are you playing the bass? C.
Right.
See, already I copped something. It's only the first tune.
It really doesn't mean anything.
Well, it does, because if you have something that sets a mood, because, you know, to me that's a sad song, Old Folks. I don't know if you know. Well, I'm sure you must. Mm-hmm. You must know the lyrics to
right,
a lot of
I
tunes.
Right.
Ben, isn't it Ben Webster that always worked? Everything he did, he
that's
knew
right.
the lyrics.
That's right.
And one night he came off shaking his head and didn't like the way he played the tune, and somebody said to him, "What's the matter?" And he says, "I forgot the lyric." I don't know.
Yeah, a lot of instrumentalists take that very seriously. I do to some extent, and I don't claim to know the lyrics to everything I play. Many of the things I play, I learn the lyric because I happen to admire the fusion between a great lyric and certainly a great melody. And I don't try to get too romantic about trying to make the song sound like the lyric, because that would be untrue. But
no.
I do remain cognizant of the fact that a certain lyric has been written for this particular song.
Yeah. Back to the technical aspects of things. Like, even on that song, you managed to include so many clear and clean octaves and certain runs that you do, which, again, are your trademark. Where did you ever learn to do that? As a kid? Did you start very young?
I started at 5, Marion, and I started classically, of course, and I went through the Czerny, Hannon, Duck Nanny, and so forth.
Oh, God.
But also...
Those are hard. if you get all those down. Did you all those?
Well, I didn't go through them all, but I certainly went through enough of this. Certainly Czerny. I found I retained an interest in Czerny because he's so linear, and you know, for the lines in jazz, you need that kind of thing, I think. But also what I found out was that the easiest way to get over all of the hassles of playing the piano, which is really what we're talking about, because to, you know, you need a vocabulary, as we both know, or else you can't communicate. And I decided that it would be easier to try and get rid of all of the technical digital hassles. And what I did was I would take lines and just sing lines to myself and make myself play them like anything.
What a great idea.
And once I did that, I had a premise that if I could play that with one hand, there was no reason why I shouldn't be able to play with two. Or close enough. The thing is, and that graduated to points where maybe now, certainly recently since the advent of my solo period in my life, I sometimes now, not too often, venture into playing fours or eights one hand to the other. But in doing what I did with the trying to get the hands together, I learned to respect the fact that I think people have a misguided concept about piano. They think that because if they're right-handed, they look at their right hand, they see the thumb sitting on the left end of the hand, and they immediately figure the left hand is that way, except that maybe the little finger is playing the part of the thumb. And I found this to be untrue a long time ago. They're two separate types of fingering. And if you can overcome that kind of thought where you try to force the left hand, it's like making a left-handed person right-handed. You know. And I think once you overcome that, I found that I had a lot less trouble.
So you really... you've thought that through, and that really practically made you ambidextrous. Well, it did make you ambidextrous.
Well, I think most pianists are ambidextrous in their thoughts anyway. I think they want to be. You know,
yeah, I am in my thoughts, but watch me when I get to the piano.
No, most of them, but you have to play when you play and accompany yourself like this. If you're playing, there are two separate lines going.
True.
So regardless of the simplicity, there's a split thinking there. So you just increase that split thinking. I think everyone does to their own particular needs.
How about another tune?
A quick view.
Oh, that's got to be a very swinging place.
It is a very busy little place in Montreal.
Well, we'll leave the interview there for now, but we can come back to it later, I hope. Right now, I think we'll pick up the career. He was talking about, was it a duo or a trio or so on, and I think we should pick up with the first trio, which was certainly roughly where I came along and found out about Oscar Peterson. He was playing with Barney Kessel. He made a drumless trio, Barney Kessel on the guitar, of course, the ever-present Ray Brown on the bass. This is from 1952. At this stage, Norman Granz's management was really beginning to bite, and he managed Peterson's career wonderfully well. He produced an idea which was to produce songbook albums. This was way ahead of the Ella Fitzgerald songbook albums, which are also, of course, conditioned by Mr. Granz. This is one of the first ones. He did a batch of four. He recorded them all in a couple of days. This is one of the first ones. It was the Duke Ellington songbook by, just to be perverse, I'm going to play you a track called John Hardy's Wife, which is actually by Ellington's son, Mercer Ellington. John Hardy's Wife there from 1952. The trio with Barney Kessel. Just for contrast, I'll play a track now, a really cracking track actually, with Herb Ellis replacing Barney Kessel. He replaced him after about a year, and most people seem to think that Herb Ellis was a better fit. I'm never quite sure myself, but certainly if these two tracks are anything to go by, then Herb Ellis wins by a country mile. This is a pretty well-known tune. It's called Sweet Georgia Brown. Thank you. always amazes me when you hear those club recordings. The crowd in the background appear to be just getting on with their lives and drinking and smoking and having fun, and they're not listening to the music at all, and yet there it is in front of them, perhaps the most marvellous music they're ever likely to hear in a lifetime. Well, now, let's go back to that interview with Marion McPartland. We'll join it. He's just played a lovely solo version of Like Someone in Love, and she compliments him on that, and then we'll see what happens after that.
That was fun. Beautiful. Kind of tippy-toe. Oh, it was a kick. I have to say for you that you've had, you know, from that day I first heard you, to me it's always seemed you've had a consistency and a flow and a direction that has only become greater as the years go by. You know,
thank you, man. I look on this instrument, I can only answer that by saying, I try never to take this instrument for granted, and the medium, of course. I look at this instrument as a new affair every night, every time I play it. And I never come in and say, oh yeah, I got to play, it doesn't matter. And people may think that, because they see me walk into a concert hall, and if the plane was a little late, I walk in at maybe 8:20 and walk right on stage at 8:30. But mentally, I'm not taking this instrument for granted. I have too much respect for it.
When you come in, like you came in the other night, and you played... You sat down and played Old Folks, and I thought to myself, now, did he have the whole set in his mind before he got to the stand, or did he do it as he went along, or did you have the whole set planned out, or did you?
No, I never planned sets, because you never really know what works, or I don't. I hope things are going to work, but there's no guarantee, and I can sometimes come in and say to Niels, if we're going to start together, mm-hmm. he'll say, what are you going to play? I said, well, what do you want to play? And he'll pick something. And I'll say, okay, and I'll get up to the stand, and suddenly I'll say, no, let's not do that. Do this instead. You know,
I'm glad to hear I'm not the only one that does that. I just figured, you know, I do that same thing.
I think all pianists do it. The other thing I used to do, which was very harassing to the group, was that I had a terrible memory, not about what tunes are this, but I couldn't remember keys. And I'd write an arrangement, a pretty hard arrangement in one key, and I'd come in, and I'd say, okay, we're going to play The Thrill Is Gone or something, whatever it was, and I'd be hovering over one note, getting ready to count it off, and Ray would look down and say, what are you going to do with that note? You know, and I said, well, it's a starting note. He said, well, you're playing this as a solo, because I don't know it in that key. Or, you know, we hadn't rehearsed it in that key. And I did get into some of those things different nights, and that's one of the things, I guess, that gives you a certain amount of control over key signatures and things, if you get into those holes.
Ray is such a devil. I love to think what he would have done if you had said, yes, we are going to play it in that key.
Yeah, he did not. He would have gone on the mic and said, ladies and gentlemen, Oscar Peterson is now going to play a solo.
Oh.
And gone off the stage.
Again, I love that line I read somewhere about you guys, probably Herb Ellis, or I don't know, different guitarists you've had, and Ray, you know, that everybody's out to get each other.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
every night it was a threatening contest. I'd come downstairs or come into the club, and they'd look at me and say, how do you feel? I said, I feel good. I said, I hope so. Why? I said, because we're going to waste you tonight. You know, that was the attitude.
Oh, I love it.
Oh, it's a great attitude, because, you know, as much as it was a kibitz, I'd say to myself, subconsciously, and I'd say, well, I just better maybe stretch out a little on them the first set so they won't think they can actually do it. And meanwhile, they're mentally probably thinking the same thing, saying, well, you know, he probably thinks we're kidding when he said that, but let's get him anyway. So I think, if anything, the audience and the listeners benefited from any event that went on.
Oh, probably. Oh, I love all that interplay. You know, George Shearing and I have been doing a few two-piano things, and he's like that. He doesn't say anything, but every minute he's trying to waste me. And he does.
You're not too easily wasteable.
He changes key. He'll play some stride piano.
Oh, yeah.
He'll do things that are really, really mean, you know. But I love it. I love every minute of it. Well, listen, I'm talking a lot. How about another tune, another solo from you?
All right.
Body and Soul?
Yeah, it's one of my favorite tunes. I'd like to do that.
Oh, I love that tune. Thank you.
pretty much perfection, really. That's Body and Soul, as played just quietly in a studio with Marion McPartland and Oscar Peterson there by himself on the piano. Well, we'll leave that interview for now. Maybe come back to some next week, I'm not sure, but it's quite difficult because it's all solo stuff, and of course we want to have a varied kind of a programme, don't we? Now, I'm just going to take one more number, which will be, roughly speaking, the quartet that we heard right at the top of the programme. Oh, and a different guitar player, actually. This is the Swedish guitar player, Ulf Fokenius. But Nils Henning Orsted Pedersen on the bass and the splendid Martin Drew on the drums. I guess Peterson's most famous composition will end up being Hymn to Freedom, not just because of its title, but also because it is a fine, fine hymn to freedom or to anything else. This is a live version. It was recorded on an album called A Summer Night in Munich in 1998, I think. Let's have a listen. just about play out on this one, but I hope you'll join me next week for the second part of The Big P, Oscar Peterson. If you have been, thanks for listening.
All artists face this stark choice: ape what's gone before, or become a revolutionary. Most musicians take the soft option, not Charlie Parker. Before Parker stormed onto the scene, people understood what the word jazz meant. But during the 1940s, you were expected to take sides. You either favored the old or the new. On Sunday's Jazz Alley, we assess the legacy of Bird 50 years after his death. That's Jazz Alley with myself, Eamon Lenehan, 7 o'clock Sunday evening on RTE Lyric FM.